Through Interaction 19.0, the story behind the story series. I'm Neeta Aneja, and I'm the founder of Trends, which is a platform for art, cultural, social, and literary experiences. And with me is my co-host, Shreya. She's a writer, she's a spoken word poetess, and an architecture student. We started our virtual author interaction series in July 2020. And today, in our 19th author interaction series, we have none other than India's most influential columnist, and I'm very, very proud to say, a very, very popular journalist and someone who's not averse to controversy, Ms. Tavleen Singh. Tavleen has studied at Vellum's School and St. Bede's, Shimla. She has worked at Evening Mail, The Statesman, Telegraph, Sunday Times, London, many more before being a freelancer with India Today and Indian Express. Tavleen is India's most influential political journalist and commentator. She's the author of India's Broken Tryst, Kashmir, A Tragedy of Errors, Why India Will Survive Its Politicians, and many more. And today, we discuss a frank, fast, and a very hard-hitting reckoning of Narendra Modi's premiership from one of his very, very early supporters. So we discuss today Messiah Modi, A Tale of Great Expectation by HarperCollins and written by one and only Tavleen Singh. So welcome, Tavleen. It's such a pleasure to have you with us today.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
We are really indeed quite excited to know about your book. I've read the book and I personally absolutely adore it. I'm sure every one of us in the room will be so eager to lay their hands on it as soon as the session is over. And it's a great tale, and it's a great story, and it's really written very, very well.
Thank you.
So it's indeed a great opportunity, in fact, Tavleen, to know you better. You know, all of us have been wanting, you know, since we declared this session, you know, there have been so many people who've been really wanting to know you. And they've been reading about you, they've been reading about your story and the story behind this book. So let us walk through your journey of writing. How did you start? And I mean, where you are? I mean, you are at such a pinnacle right now. Yes.
How did I start journalism? How did I start to do journalism? Or writing as an author? You want the whole story or just the writing story?
Whole story. The whole story behind the story.
Okay, I actually had no real education because I finished school at the age of 14. And, you know, in Vellum, they got my age wrong. It was a very new school. And my sister, who was only 13 months younger than me, was three years lower. So I actually came out of school very, very young. And my mother in those days, all the, you know, women were supposed to do, this is the 60s, right? And she wanted me to get married and, you know, try to marry me off to a man who died of drink quite soon afterwards. So it's just as well that that didn't succeed. But I didn't want to, you know, get married. I was only 16 years old when I finished college. So I decided that I would do something else, you know, just to sort of keep away from marriage. So I went to the New Delhi Polytechnic in South Extension, which was very new then. And I looked for the shortest course, and the shortest course was journalism. And then it turned out that I seemed to, you know, I seemed to have found exactly what I wanted to do. So I was, you know, I stumbled into journalism in that way. And then again, there were no jobs for journalists, for women journalists at that time. You know, the only women journalists were Barkha's mother, Prabha, and a couple of other, Usha Rai. There were about five women journalists in the whole of India. And anyway, so I couldn't really get a job. And so I started to work as a secretary for an Englishman in the Ford Foundation. I, you know, I'd learned shorthand and typing in Vellum School because I did it instead of geography. So I didn't know that the earth moved around the sun, but I did learn how to do shorthand and typing. So when he, you know, saw that, he said that I was the worst secretary that he had ever had. And he said to me, do you want to do anything else? Isn't there anything else you want to do? And I said, I'd really like to be a journalist. So he talked to somebody in he knew who worked for a small newspaper in an ugly little English town called Slough. And so, you know, I went off there to do 2.5 years of training, which was very, very useful. And then I came back and started working in the Statesman. And then, you know, then the rest is all well known.
Yes, absolutely right. Rest is absolutely a history, absolutely. Let me talk about your book, Masiya Modi. Hmm. Your book, Masiya Modi, is indeed has been making a lot of waves. For all
good, good.
What do you think in hindsight should have been the title of your book? I read somewhere that, you know, it could have been Masiya Modi or maybe Failed Modi. So what do you think should have been the, did you have a recollection? Maybe you would like to change the title of the book, or it has to be Masiya Modi or maybe Failed Modi, or how is it?
No. In the title, when I say Masiya Modi, there's a question mark, you know, and I basically, and then there's a subtitle which says A Tale of Great Expectations. I actually believe that I got it right somehow, because in his second term, we've seen him become more and more like a Masiha than a political leader. He even started looking, he looks more like a rishi now with his long beard, and, you know, and because of the COVID thing, he hardly meets anybody. So he's very isolated. And he's like a kind of, you know, messiah figure in the distance somewhere. So I think I got it right. And also I find that in his second term, the reason why he has made more mistakes than he did in his first term, there were mistakes in the first term as well, is because he seems to think of himself as being above the ordinary role of a political leader. I'm not sure that's very good for him or for India, but I wouldn't change the title. I think I got it right.
It's a very striking, especially with the question mark, yes. It's a very striking title. Do you think Prime Minister has fulfilled his duties? I mean, how do you think he's different from Modi 1.0 to Modi 2.0? How would you?
Modi 1.0 seemed much more interested in taking India forward. He made mistakes with demonetization, as I say in the book, was really his first major mistake with the economy. Mm? No, actually, yeah, I think the first major mistake was, you see, India could not have gone on in the way that the Congress Party was running India. Yeah, the socialism with officials who can barely, you know, do a job, being given charge of running the economy of a country the size of a subcontinent was a big mistake, because otherwise there's no reason for India to be a poor country. So before he became prime minister, which is one of the reasons why I supported him, he kept talking about taking India in a new economic direction. And he started to do that. And then, and I mentioned this in the book as well, Rahul Gandhi made that suit boot ki sarkar, you know, remark in the Lok Sabha, tum to suit boot ki sarkar ho, to which the answer should have been, kya sirf tum suit boot pehn sakte ho, you know, kyun nahi har Bharat ke nagrik ko ye hak ho, or, you know, sambhavna ho ki suit boot pehen sake. Instead of that, he seemed to change course and went back to the same policies that Sonia Gandhi had started, which actually tanked the Indian economy. You know, we till about 2006, the Indian private sector was booming, jobs were growing, the middle class was growing. Everything was looking really as if we could, you know, begin to compete with China economically. And then Madam Sonia decided that she would take us back to the socialist path. And, you know, again, the idea of bantuing khairat, you know, free food, and, you know, instead of rozgar, you call it the rozgar yojana, but it's actually a berozgari ka bhatta that you get, you know, for people who are berozgar. So he unfortunately changed track. And I think that that was the really big mistake that he made in his thing. then I think now that he's in Modi 2.0 phase, I think the big mistake has been to concentrate on the Hindutva agenda and not the economy. So the economy actually was in a slide even before COVID hit. And once COVID hit, you know, you can see what's going on with, we went down to minus 23%, the growth rate, which is worse than any other country in the world. So, you know, I don't know what he's going to do to help us recover. But that first lockdown, I thought was a big mistake because, you know, he seems not to have even noticed the migrant workers that they would need to go back, you know? So now let's see what he does. But I just hope that this crisis that we're in makes him focus once more on the economy. He's made some reforms recently in agriculture, which is good. But he really needs to let the country go. You know, he needs to let every Indian who wants to make money or run a business to do that. So far, that hasn't happened.
You're so right. You're absolutely right. You know, especially with GST implementation, with, you know, this corruption being still so rampant, with jobs not there. And a lot of problems. I would also say, I mean, I've been a follower and I've been also, frankly, I've always followed him and I've always felt there is no other alternative to Mr. Modi. But don't you think a country as big as this, as big as India, with so many problems, do you think anybody can really handle us?
Yes.
I mean, I'd like to know from you.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. If you really decentralize, let the states compete with each other economically. Instead of, you see, the mistake that Mr. Nehru made was in thinking that he could do everything from Delhi, right? And I very much fear that Mr. Modi, because he thinks of himself as being a messiah, he started to think of himself as kind of big patriarch who can do everything from Delhi. You can't. We are at different levels of development in different states in India. And, you know, I promise you, I'm beginning to hear this already. Our southern and western states that are doing much better than, for instance, the northern states, the UP, Bihar particularly, at some point are going to say, why should we pay for these guys to take us, drag us down the whole time? Now, you know, you've got states the size of countries. Let them run their own economies. Let them run their own education systems, healthcare. If he just decentralizes, it'll solve the problem. But, you know, so far there's no sign. In fact, the opposite has been happening. And that is worrying.
That's right. I think you've given a very good solution. You're absolutely right, that decentralization might be the solution to a lot of problems that the country is facing right now. And in fact, even purpose of such conversations, the one that we are having now, it's very valuable. It's very important to have these continuous dialogues to discuss what we can do rather than, you know, pulling people back. We have to find out solutions, and maybe through forums like these, we can really offer, and there'll be people to listen to, you know, the solutions that we might be offering. Coming back to the book, Messiah Modi by HarperCollins and written by you, is a revealing chronicle of Mr. Modi's regime so far. It traces your journey from being such an enthusiastic supporter. I personally have followed you for so many years. I remember 2013, way back then, you were really a very, very enthusiastic supporter of his, and now to a disillusioned observer. Indeed, a very hard-hitting reckoning of Mr. Modi's premiership is this book, Messiah Modi. So what was the reason and the need to write this book, especially when you, as a seasoned and a popular and somebody who's, as I mentioned, not averse to controversy journalist, wrote this knowing that there'll be a backlash?
Well, to tell you the truth, I didn't know that there would be a backlash because the book was commissioned by HarperCollins in 2018, September. And they wanted it to come out at the same time as the 2019 election. So it was mostly written before. I just updated it after that. They wanted a fair account, you know, of his first term in office. And so they asked me to write the book. So that's the reason why I wrote it. I would not have written it on my own because I actually didn't think of the need for it. They did. HarperCollins wanted this book written. And then my suggestion was that we wait till the election results rather than, you know, because otherwise it would be irrelevant, you know, unless. So we waited for the election results. And I'm very glad that we did, because then it becomes more meaningful, because, you know, I take it right up to the agitations over the Citizens, Amendment Act. And so that's the story of the book. But I wanted also to put the perspective on what had made him such a big figure in Indian politics. And to me, which I recount in the book, you know, the state of India in 2013 was really gloomy. I don't know whether you remember it. The economy was in the doldrums. We had Mama Sonia with only one aim in life, to promote, you know, her little sunny boy as everyone in the Congress party, almost every MP was the son of someone or the daughter of someone. And here was this man who came from nowhere and who luckily for us had no children, you know? So he actually seemed like a man who could make that difference that India needed so badly, you know? I remember, and I recount the travels. I remember traveling in Rajasthan after he made his first speech at the Sriram College of Commerce in Delhi. That was his first step towards becoming prime minister. And, you know, ordinary people in villages which had voted Congress said to me, "Ki ji, hum to Modi ko vote denge." And I said, "Kyun?" And they said, "Ji, hum inki ye jo baatein kar rahe hain, humko bahut pasand hai. Kyunki ye arthvyavastha ko mazboot karne ki baatein kar rahe hain, rozgar dene ki baatein kar rahe hain." And, you know, I mean, that was the big appeal, because Congress, after 70 years, had kept India desperately poor. Why should India be a poor country? We have every state in India, almost every state in India, could actually make their economy strong just on tourism. And the first prime minister to talk about that was Modi. You know, I mean, look at a state like Bihar. And if you drive from, say, Patna to Bodh Gaya, just out of the Buddha story, Bihar could be a rich country. But they didn't take that route, you know? And I'm very sad that actually, even though they look as though they're winning Bihar again, they still haven't done that. You hear Nitish Kumar saying, ke jo samudra kinare jo rajya hote hain, wahan pe udyog lagte hain. Yahan pe kaun aayega? Forget the udyog, just to tourism. You know, I mean, look at, we've got mountains, we've got beaches, we've got more tourism potential than almost any other country in the world. And it's unexploited because we're still trying to give jobs and, you know, we're trying to follow China's path, and that path is gone. You know, we've got to now find a new road. And I really hope that he still finds it.
Let's wish, absolutely. Coming back again, you know, I was pretty disturbed when all this backlash was happening. And I was thinking, why are we as an Indian state becoming so increasingly sensitive? Why do you think we are so sensitive about issues so much? I mean, about this, this is a well-written book and you need to support it. I've been always questioning that. Why are we really becoming very increasingly sensitive?
Well, don't forget that I've lived through Indira Gandhi's times. And, you know, during the emergency, there was full press censorship. And, but we defied it. And, you know, everyone was very excited to take her on and to defy press censorship. What is very worrying, which I keep writing about in my column, is that in the case of Modi, if you criticize him, you become the enemy, not just a critic. So what he's done is he's actually, there are a couple of channels, I don't want to mention any names, but which are actually more spokespeople or, you know, platforms for the government than Doordarshan is. They actually only take a position. It's as if they're sitting with some guy in the Home Ministry or the Ministry of Information telling them what position to take on a particular issue. And, you know, I mean, I don't know whether you saw my column, which has been very controversial, the one I wrote against Arnab, saying that after what he'd done to Ria, it also was in the Indian Express, the same subject. And it's been controversial because people feel I shouldn't have attacked a colleague. Now, the thing is that what really upset me about what Arnab did in the Ria Chakrabarti case was that he actually demanded her arrest. And for what? First, they tried to charge her with murder. This was all done on television. It wasn't just, you know, Arnab. The Times Now did it, and a couple of other, you know, anchors actually went out. So they've ruined the life of this girl. They put a 20-year-old girl in jail. For what? Maybe she smoked a few joints and, you know, maybe she bought a bit of charas or ganja for, you know, Sushant Singh Rajput. But I mean, the quantities they were talking about are less than you would find in any sadhuon ka mat. You know, it's the most commonly used intoxicant in India is charas and ganja. And there are now, you know, marijuana is considered almost, it's legal in many states in America. It's legal in many countries in Europe. And for that, you've gone after Bollywood. And on all of this, the reason why this happened was it seemed like a concerted attack on Bollywood by the government, you know, by the central government. For what? For what? So, you know, I mean, I'm very worried about, and I think the reason is, to come back to your question, Bollywood doesn't take dictation from Delhi. You know, journalists can, TV journalists can even more. But in the case of Bollywood, they make that movies that sell at the box office. There, you know, judges the box office. So I think this attempt to control Bollywood and change it, very worrying. Very worrying. And to make journalists into enemies. You know, our job is to be on the adversaries of the government, to be critics, watchdogs. So, you know, I really hope that, you know, Messiah Modi realizes that we're not the enemy.
Right. So much for freedom of speech, I would say, right? Because journalist's job is definitely to do a balanced job. And that is very important.
In the book, I praise the Swachh Bharat program. Absolutely. Wherever Modi deserves praise, I've praised him.
What people need to know. This book is not only about as it looks and as it is being portrayed. It's so much to do with very real facts, and we need to read it so that we come to know. And I feel, I mean, coming back to my next question, which is very simple, very related to this. See, I personally would definitely admit that this book is indeed a free-flowing read. And I would definitely recommend to those who closely follow the Modi government and are keen observers of Indian policies in general. Your writing, Tavleen, is definitely accessible. I mean, it is very fluent read. But I would really like to know if you would personally like to recommend this book, as I was discussing with you earlier, to Modi ji. And why do you think he should read it?
I think he should read it because I actually think it's a very honest critique of his first term in office. You know, it's, my criticism of him starts with demonetization, which I think was a big mistake. And with Yogi Adityanath being made, chief minister of UP, at a time when there were already the lynchings of Muslims and, you know, I mean, it's for me, India, what I'm really proud about as an Indian is that we've managed to keep a liberal democracy alive in a very poor country, in a country that had nothing else, but it had the idea of the Sanatan Dharma, you know, which is an open idea which does not target anybody particularly, and which allows you the freedom, because our idea of secularism comes from that. You know, that the state has nothing to do with it. It's, if you want to worship Hanuman, go right ahead and do that. And if you want to keep a fast for Santoshi Ma, don't do that. You know, I mean, that is what's the beauty of India. And I feel that this kind of uniform Hindutva that is being banged down our throats is a big mistake. It won't work. And it'll just create more divisions in a country that is already showing signs of very serious divisions.
One of my question was, I think you need to answer that. You just said that why Modi should read it. But given a chance, I know he's not talking to you, as you mentioned earlier, to me. And do you think, given a chance, would you privately tell him wrong? And would you like to give him a suggestion?
I would like to go and present it to him, like I did with my last book, India's Broken Tryst, where, you know, I managed to go in and talk to him and, you know, we chatted and I told him what I thought was going wrong. And do you know the thing with Mr. Modi is that if he gives you time, he gives you how much ever time you want, you know, so you can sit with him for as long as you want to. You almost have to say, okay, you know, I'm taking too much of your time. So I chatted to him for an hour. And, you know, at that point, this was 2016. There was only one lynching of Muhammad Akhlaq. And I remember saying to him, why don't you say something? Say that this is wrong and it'll stop. And he said, you know, if I start speaking, he said, is desh mein roz kuch na kuch hota hai, galat hota hai. Aur agar main baar baar bolunga, to kab tak bolta rahunga? You know, so that was his excuse. But I think that was a weak excuse, because had he signaled that he didn't want this, because, you know, if we're going to start having people being allowed, or, you know, being, you know, a dog whistle being given to them to go ahead and do what they're doing, you know, without law and order, there is no democracy. So, you know, if law and order becomes something that people can take into their own hands, we've had it. We literally have. So I would like very much to go and see him and give him the book and say, please read it, sir.
I'm sure he's heard about it. Maybe, for all you know, he would have read it.
You see, the already. The problem with these guys is, I don't know about him, but many of the people around him, they don't read. You know, I often get attacked because they've read a headline. Or, you know, I mean, they don't sign with the bhai isme aapne question mark kyun dal diya. So, you know, I mean, that means that you don't think he's the Messiah. You know, we don't need a Messiah. That's the reason for the question mark. And, you know, anyway, I would like very much to go and give it to him. I hope he watches this program. And if you have any influence, tell him that he should see me and I will give him a copy of the book signed.
I'd like to have his sign on the book and you give it back to me.
I'll do that.
I personally have been, like everyone else, Modi ji's observer and to some extent a follower too. But yes, I somehow feel quite disillusioned the way we are progressing as a nation.
What are you disillusioned about?
The way things are going on right now, you know, you find, I mean, I know you are a journalist, you're more closer to the facts which is happening, you know, anything which is happening. I know there are a lot of things which went wrong in Republic TV, but yes, the way he was handled, or rather mishandled, and the way he was taken. I mean, there's so many issues. I mean, it was beginning with demonetization and then the citizen amendment bill, so many things happening. And we as a general public also feel quite concerned. But at the end of the day, Tavleen, I mean, do we have somebody who can replace him? Do you think we have an alternative? Do you think there is a strong contender we have to replace him? I mean, what do you have to say about that?
No, we don't. Because actually the Congress party, which is the only national party other than the BJP, all the others are regional parties. The Congress party has reduced itself to being a little private business, you know, I mean, a family firm. You know, there's Mama Sonia and her two children, you know, and they listen even less than Mr. Modi does. You know, they haven't learned a single lesson in the past 6 years. I mean, normally a party that has been out of power for 6 years should have considered what went wrong, you know? I mean, what have we done wrong? Are we raising the wrong issues? Secondly, there's no sign yet that they've started to rebuild the party. You can only rebuild the party from the bottom. You know, as long as you have this little darbar in Delhi and everyone has to go and do farshi salam to mama, you know, before they can, to Bharat Mata Sonia, you know what I mean? There's no way you're going to create a political party after that, you know? So I don't see them as an alternative. I don't see Rahul Gandhi at all as an alternative at the moment. But I would like for an alternative to emerge to keep Mr. Modi from, you know, thinking of himself as a messiah. You know, he's a political leader and he must remember that he's not the messiah.
Very valid point, I must say. One thing which I really, you know, I've read your book and I've read about you so many times. And one thing I really want to know, what is one factor in your personality which really keeps you going against everything which goes negative at times? We've read your tweets, we have read about it. So what is one personality and what is one message you want to give to people here, the way you keep going strong against all odds?
I'm by nature quite optimistic and hopeful. And I've been doing yoga for about 30 years. And I do it almost every day. Like the Prime Minister, we have that in common. And I find that, you know, on a day that I can't do it, that I start to feel a bit low, etc. So I think that yoga, I don't do much meditation because I'm not very good at meditation. I try very hard. But also, you know, I'm very proud of being Indian. I'm very, you know, I want to see India. I'm 70 years old now. And, you know, I really hoped that Modi would be the man who would change India. You know, there have been moments of great change that I've seen, you know. Narasimha Rao transformed India. Atal Bihari Vajpayee did his bit. Manmohan Singh, you know, there was a transformation that had happened. There were people, instead of, you know, there was a time when I first became a journalist, when the only jobs in India were government jobs. Everybody wanted a government job, whether they wanted it as a peon or whether they wanted it as a bada saab. The only jobs were government jobs. And then because of those reforms that Narasimha Rao brought about, suddenly there were gyms and restaurants and, you know, there were jobs everywhere in places you'd never think of. Hotels started to open. Do you know, it really made huge changes. That is what I find missing in, since Modi became Prime Minister, that, you know, that kind of really big transformation hasn't happened yet.
I know this is what really makes you strong, and you are an incorrigible optimist, I must say. So are you still hoping against hope that Modi ji gets back his charisma?
He has the charisma. You know, a lot of Indians still think of him as a great leader, and he, despite all his mistakes. It's not charisma that he's missing. I'm hoping that he starts to listen more, that he actually opens his ear, he puts his ear back on the ground and listens to what people like you and people, ordinary citizens, what are their grievances? You can't be isolated from the people, you know, you can't surround yourself with bureaucrats, you know. I mean, I really believe that the biggest criminals in India, the reason why we always hold back rather than go forward, are the bureaucrats, because they like control and because, you know, they've remained like the colonial bureaucrats living in those big houses in Latians Delhi, you know, which they should have no right to live in. They should live like you and I. But I really hope that he starts listening more and starts thinking of himself as a political leader who really wants to do what is right for India and not as a messiah, you know, who just wants to be this great messiah, you know, the figure at the top. We don't need a rishi, you know? I mean, we need a political leader. I hope he realizes that.
coming back to your book, Davleen, how long did it take you to write this book? You did mention that you had revised it after 2018.
I started writing it in September 2018, I think. And I finished just after the election. I mean, I handed it to the publisher by the end of 2019. Yeah. Yeah.
Would you like to show the book to the viewers, please?
I would love to. Here it is, guys. Go and buy it and read it. It's very readable, even if I say so myself.
And Davleen, before taking much time, there are a lot of people who would like to ask you questions directly about you, about the book. And I would like Shreya to announce the interactive round. Shreya?
Okay.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for staying here. And I must say that was a lovely conversation. And I really agree with you that for the integrity of a democracy to be maintained, the leader has to come on the road and you know, see and sit with the people and recognize and listen to their grievances. And it's very easy for him to do that right now, I feel, because of COVID specifically, there are so many problems that have arrived at the basic grassroots level. If you just take a walk in CP, you can just see the amount of people who have been rendered homeless just because of COVID. And I'm sure he'll realize the problem way faster and start listening more if that happens.
Absolutely.
So I think we can start with the interactive round. There are quite a few questions that were coming in, so they can ask you directly.
Start with Reena Ghai. She's an awarded women entrepreneur and a solar specialist.
Okay.
Yeah, Reena.
I think you're still mute. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, good evening. Good evening, Davleen ji. I have a question. My question is, in 2019, Mr. Ashok Kumar Upadhyay, he filed an RTI. And the RTI was, how many press conferences Prime Minister Modi has done so far? Please provide date/location. And the PMO's response to this was, the Prime Minister's interactions with press are structured and unstructured, and therefore information asked for is not available on record. Now, my question to you, given this context, is, do you view this selective interviews, press interaction, as undemocratic? Or is it a political strategy to not engage in discourse and direct discourse? That is the part A of my question. The part B of the question is, why are journalists and organizations like the Press Club of India, why are they mute spectators to this kind of a totalitarian methodology of communication?
Okay. For a start, I want to say that there is a precedent for it. Sonia Gandhi has never given a press conference. And it is undemocratic. It's actually the right of the media to demand press conferences. When I met him, the last time that I met him, when I went to give him my book in 2016, I suggested to him that he should do what the White House does, which is that you have a team of people who handle, you know, the media every day, right? But he, because he feels that the media was unfair to him after 2002, he doesn't really like journalists very much, unless they praise him. But you see, also again, the messiah complex, you know, when you're a political leader, even Trump, when he came to India, do you remember that he gave a press conference at which Modi didn't come? Yeah. That's unprecedented. Normally, the two leaders have to come together and give a press conference. And, you know, I think that it's very, very wrong what he's doing, because you can't do this, you know, man ki baat, and then you ask somebody like Akshay Kumar to come and interview you, and his first question, ki aapko aam kis tarah ke pasand hai, You know, I mean, this is, it's not a political question, right? So it's, I feel that he really, if he wants now to be seen as a real leader and not a messiah, he must start having press conferences. He can answer the questions. You know, he has to answer them. Exactly. And, you know, instead of that, you've got this management of the media, which I've been writing about. And, you know, it's very wrong.
And what about the totalitarianism?
It
the
is
methodology of communication.
It is signs
one-sided.
It is signs of a totalitarian mentality, and that is very worrying.
Thank you very much for answering the question. Thank you.
Ma'am, I'm very curious as to when you mentioned about the press conference, what was his answer? As in, why does he not have this precedent?
He didn't say anything. But he said, media mein samajh nahi paya hun. You know, he didn't actually give me a direct answer. But even his ministers don't question him.
Exactly.
Forget the media. I want no, you know, other than say Mr. Gadkari, who has tried to, you know, question some of the things that the bureaucrats have done. You've got a cabinet that is silent.
Exactly. I remember I was seeing some interview that was interrupted in between that he had done, I think, back in 2002, even before he was a chief minister, or just when he was elected. And I remember that interview that he had, he walked off because he was not...
Karan Thapar, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And that is the extent of what I've seen when it comes to him giving an interview, which is not, you know, structured beforehand.
Yeah. No, it's not good for him. It's not good for him. Because do you know that after the emergency, Indira Gandhi was asked what she would have done again if she had a chance. And she said, I would never have imposed press censorship. Because you see, the media is actually not just a watchdog, it's also a source of information for government, exactly. Right? And if there's no interaction with the media, how are you going to find out what people are saying? So for instance, what you just said, if you could just walk down Crown Place and see the number of people who become homeless, or in the village in which I live, if you could see that in the bazaar, there are these young men who have no jobs. And they're sitting there like, you know, I'm just waiting for any job. He should be, you know, he should be listening to those voices.
That's very true. And, you know, when we look at US also, when there is Donald Trump, you've seen over the last 4 years, so much of criticism has happened. And people have come out and very openly joked about him, talked about him, and there was no censorship. So I think that is... a very important precedent, actually, which is in favor of Donald Trump, oddly.
Yes. So, and you know, he knows how to handle the press. When he sees those CNN guys, he says, you don't come near me. You guys are really bad guys. I'm not talking to you and all that. But that's better than not talking to the media.
Exactly. I agree. I think we can go to the next question.
Next, we have Alka Khanna.
Yes.
And she's a social entrepreneur. And she's an ex-Velemite.
Well, your book seems very interesting and I would like to read it. I think Modi being Modi, because he's come from rags to riches, literally, I think people were expecting too much from him. And I think, I don't know, because na aage na piche, people thought bas he has a magic wand and he will do wonders in this country. But this country, India, I feel India on paper and Bharat in reality are two different countries. And it's not a joke. We need somebody really, really, somebody very, very smart to change India and the Indians, mind you. I feel the main problem in India are the Indians as well.
Well, listen, he has brought about a social revolution. Let's not forget that the elite people like you and I who speak English represent is irrelevant now. The papers that matter are Dainik Jagran, Dainik Bhaskar, Amar Ujala. The television channels that matter are the Hindi channels. the people, the language of government, the kind of, you know, the change that has come about in government offices is phenomenal. So, you know, one of the reasons why people identify, ordinary people identify more with him is because he comes from them. You know, he's not some grandson of a prime minister, etc. And that social revolution is important. You know, it's something that I have to write a column in Hindi to be relevant, really. You know, I mean, the Hindi column is important. So, you know, those are things that are very important. And it's because he comes from the people rather than from, you know, a palace. Swachh Bharat is one of the most incredible social changes that has happened. You know, so we have to give him credit for that. He is a revolutionary in his fashion. You know, we may not like everything he's doing, but that social revolution has happened.
I don't know, but I feel people are expecting too much from him. And I agree with you, the real problem in our country is the bureaucrats. And I just wish there would be very many judiciary changes that would be brought up. You know, we are still living with the same British Raj rules.
Absolutely.
And those lakir ke fakir kind of things.
Absolutely.
I mean, I don't know, too much needs to be changed and it should be unbiased. Well, whether there should be no religion ever even asked. Like if you go to a police person, they will first ask you your jati, your this and that. I mean, that should be banned now.
Yeah.
There should be no concession, whatever you say, no mention of any caste creed in the system. Then
that,
people will start.
That is the system that he inherited. That is the system that he is trying in his fashion to change. Don't forget that the colonial elite to which English speaking Indians belong did nothing to change that.
Yeah, true.
They didn't even change the school that you went to and I went to.
And the history we learned was all wrong.
Yeah.
I must say that. I mean, I'm ashamed that we learned so much about the Mughals and the British people and we never knew about our own heroes.
Yeah. So you've got a reaction. You know, and it's a valid reaction.
But now I would like, you know, the press, worries me is so much of our press, I don't know if it's the reality, so much is owned by the foreigners. I don't know if the press
it's
people
not.
Are really doing justice.
No, it's not owned by foreigners at all. Not
so much you keep reading that.
Not a single Indian television network or newspapers owned by foreigners. It's all owned by Indians. But we need to actually do more, even in the media, to say that, you know, I mean, why would we not talk about the, you know, the Mauryas, the Cholas?
True.
They were great emperors. We have Akbar the Great. And
there was hardly a paragraph in history about these guys. Yeah.
Exactly. Exactly.
The only thing positive about Mr. Modi's era, I would say, is that we Indians just learned to put our head up and say, yes, we are Indians. And in all over the world, I think we were recognized. But even after being so good, like abroad you go, everybody really praises the Indian people because they're so basically hardworking.
Yeah, but I wish he had done more to make the cultural changes that are needed.
Yes,
it's not just about religion. You see, Hindutva, the kind of narrow-minded, you know, to beat up a few old Muslims in the street and to, you know, try and deny them citizenship, etc. That's not what we need.
See, a lot of people tell me, ye Hindustan hai, yahan kuch nahi ho sakta. One example I give them, I said, if a metro train can be built without a problem, no Hindu, no Muslim, no temple, nothing everything was broken if it came in the way. Even people's houses were, if they came in the way. So I said, if that can be made and run so smoothly, everything, because it was just, it was needed and people realized this. But here, there's no justice. I mean, even what to Arnab, whatever he did to Ria is besides the point. But the way he was handled, I'm sure you and I would not
very
like to
wrong.
Be handled like that.
Very wrong.
Yeah.
It shouldn't happen that way. He could have been sent a summons. He could have quietly been told that there is this case, this is what the reason is. For a start, he should have bail. Bail is a right. It's not some little privilege that the government gives you. Bail is the right unless there is valid reason for it not to be given.
So this kind of a country is getting very scary. Like you dare not speak against anybody powerful or one who has money.
It's always been
on to the next question. Yes. Yeah. Thank you, Alka. That was a great conversation.
The Bellamites are very talkative.
Yeah, true.
But lovely reading your book.
Thank
really.
You. Please go ahead.
Look forward to that. Yeah.
We have Mr. Pradeep Nagpal. He's a retired senior government official from Department of Telecommunication. And Mr. Nagpal, please keep your question brief.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello. Oh, I see you there.
I'm sure you would have done a lot of extensive research while writing this book. But Mr. Modi has been propagating that previous governments have not managed our country and the country has not progressed. Whereas the economic growth during UPA's rule was about 8%, and today we are sliding and at about 5% or so. He promised that hundreds of smart cities would come up in India. We don't see any light of any city, smart city coming in past years of his rule. Do you think it is justified to call him a messiah of our country when he has been speaking of so many projects, so many things, but on ground reality, we hardly see anything?
Okay.
People have suffered.
No, you're absolutely right. I think that he is wrong to dismiss all the former leaders as if they've done nothing at all for India. But I'm not calling him a messiah. I'm actually putting a question mark and saying, why does he seem to think that he's a messiah? I'm not calling him a messiah Modi in any way. That's what they're upset about, is that I've put a question mark there. And secondly, we don't need messiahs. We need political leaders. You know, we need a real political leader.
And this is what I want to hear from you. We need people who will take our country forward.
Yes.
Rather than we have a messiah who is saying this will happen, that will happen, but on ground reality, things do not work out.
Please people read the book. That's exactly what I've said in the book, that we don't need a messiah. You know, and I hope he realizes this too. And you're absolutely right about smart cities. Nothing has happened. It's just, you know, words. And that is one of his big flaws in his government structure. And the reason for it is, I mean, I don't want to say this in a bad way, but don't take it in a bad way, but it's the bureaucracy. You see, when you don't build a political team of chief ministers and ministers and, you know, and political ground rules, you know, political workers at the ground, then the bureaucrat takes over. And I'm sorry to say this, but Mr. Modi is surrounded by a bureaucracy that doesn't let him hear anything. And that's one of his big problems.
So how do we explain that what we are looking forward in our country? The main platform of his coming to the country was, I'll bring industrialization, I will bring business, I will bring money in the hand of people. But on ground, how much money people have got or poor people have got job, they have lost their job.
Absolutely right.
Absolutely different than what he has been promising the country.
This is absolutely true. And I hope that this crisis, the COVID crisis, will make him realize where he's gone wrong. And, you know, that he will, I said that earlier when I was talking to Nita, that, you know, you've got to let people breathe. You can't have business if every 2 minutes there's some inspector telling you this, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do this. And, you know, that has become very much worse under him. So, you know, I'm hoping that this crisis will make him change his attitude.
Thank you.
Right.
I think one of the last questions we have in the interactive round is by Jaya Goyal. Jaya, in fact, is the chairperson Women Entrepreneurs Club, and she is the person who gave me the tagline, the story behind the story for my forum. Jaya. Yes.
Namaskar, Tavleen Singh Ji. It's been such a pleasure hearing you. And Neeta, thank you for the discussion. You know, it actually, you open your mind, you start thinking. And this is something that Neeta Shreya, you've done extremely well. And Tavleen Singh Ji, I see that soft corner somewhere. And I pray with you that he listens, because I believe
in the soft corner of Modi. I still think he's the best hope we have.
Yeah, and so I see that soft corner, and how I wish he will listen. He will listen. You know, there's something that I ask myself very often, and this is something that I want to ask you now for clarity. We have Modi ji as our only hope. That's one thing. We have Arvind Kejriwal ji coming up with new, you know, very, very small initiatives that are very smart. Mm-hmm. Why can't our political leaders take the best from each other and build a stronger country? Why can't we talk country? Modi ji has vision. He definitely has vision. Why can't we put our resources together and talk about our country? This is something that I ask myself very often. Have not found an answer. And so I'm asking you, Tavleen ji, help me with...
He's governing in isolation. You know, if he was governing with, if he took along the chief ministers, if he had regular meetings with them to ask them what their problems were, what their ideas are, this is missing. This is not there. All he talks to, you know, I mean, I don't want to mention a name, but a chief minister was sitting with the chief secretary. And the chief secretary said to the chief minister, I have to go now because the prime minister has called. And the chief minister said, what do you mean you have to go? You're here as my secretary. But he was right from the beginning talking to chief secretaries, to bureaucrats, and not to the political leaders, you know, and it's the politician that has his ear closer to the ground because he has to get re-elected. The bureaucrat, once he gets a job, he's there till he virtually, you know, till he's in his dotage, you know. So I think that's a big mistake he's made, and I really hope he starts listening to his he needs a team.
Yeah, I am sure he's listening. Sure he's listening there, because and we'll make him listen too.
It's also good. It's the duty of citizens also to make him listen.
Yeah, we'll make him listen too, because we have to see the change. I like our presence on the world map, and we'll have it there economically too. Incorrigible optimist is my funda, Anita.
Let me tell you one thing. If India booms, all our political problems disappear.
Absolutely.
There will be no problem in Kashmir. The Pakis will want to join the United States of South Asia. We have no political problems in the subcontinent if India gets its economic story to really move.
Right. Absolutely. So I'm going to read the book, Tavleen ji. I haven't, but it's been such a pleasure listening to you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Neeta. Thanks, Tavleen ji. Thanks, Neeta. Thank you.
So I think we had a lovely session. Just before we close off, ma'am, if you would like to tell us a little bit about the book to the viewers who have not read it, and maybe a little bit about the inspiration behind the book.
Okay, I actually like to read books about politics and history that are stories. You know, that are stories about people, that are full of stories to tell you about Modi's rule so far, or you know, whatever, through stories, through the eyes of do you know that one of the books that has really inspired my kind of political writing was written by a woman called Nadezhda Mandelstam, and I recommend it to all of you. It's called Hope Against Hope. It taught me more about Stalin's Russia than all the history books that I read. So for me, right from the minute I wrote Darbar and all the books I've written are actually just an attempt to tell you a story, which is why they're readable, which is why a lot of people say that I'm very kind of superfluous and superficial. But I recommend it because it's easy to read and it tells you the story in very simple stories. That's the book.
Thank you. I think overall we had a very interesting session today. And it was very important because I feel the more and more we listen to both sides, the more an informed decision we can make at the end of one term. So that's very important. And that is also one of the reasons you should definitely go, who's not read the book, and you should definitely read the book. So thank you so much, ma'am, for taking out your time.
Thank you. And
I would also like to thank HarperCollins that, and also specifically Jessia for the continuous support for making our session a great success. Just before we leave, HarperCollins has been kind enough to sponsor 3 books. And so we would be announcing 3 winners for those books. That would be, one is Rena Gai, one is Sangeeta Nagrad, and one is Babita Batra. So thank you so much for being a continuous support. And we look forward to having these sessions more and more with more authors. And thank you, ma'am, again. Thank you so much. This was a very interesting session and we all had a lot to take away from this.
Thank you. It was a pleasure talking to you. And good luck with your other authors.
Thank you so much.
We really hope you come back soon and we discuss this book once again. There is so much more to discuss, and because of the time constraint, we have not been able to still touch the few questions that I had in mind, but then time, you know how it is. But it's a lovely book. I recommend to everyone. It's a great book, and it's a very good title, I would say, with a question mark that we should not miss.
Yeah, yes.
Anything that you would like to say to our viewers?
No, that's it. Read the book.
Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, HarperCollins. Thank you, Jessie. And thank you, everyone, to come in again and again. We hope to see you again for our next sessions, too.
Thank you so much. Goodbye, everyone.
Good night.
Good night.